What if you could take the expertise of Oklahoma agriculture, add the history of our state's energy industry, and mix it with good old-fashioned Oklahoma ingenuity and hard work? Could this be a recipe for something that could change the world? Basic cellulosic bioenergy research is happening around the country, converting plant materials into fuel and products we use. The National Science Foundation's Experimental Program to Stimulate Competitive Research, or EPSCoR, is funding a team of scientists and engineers from the state's three largest research facilities, Oklahoma State University, the University of Oklahoma, and the Samuel Roberts Noble Foundation.
Well, the EPSCoR program recognizes that you can't just fund one institution in trying to help a state develop its research capabilities.
The research being done now could put Oklahoma at the forefront of the bioenergy industry and lead the nation into energy self-sufficiency. Nearly all of the country's current biofuel production comes from corn-based ethanol.
The problem with corn is it takes considerable acreage just to provide energy in the form of ethanol, whereas it takes acreage away from human and animal consumption. Corn is also high in inputs, that being fertilizer, pesticides, water, and also for the growing and harvesting of the grain.
These high inputs contribute to the reason that corn ethanol returns only 1.5 times the energy for every unit used to make it. And for Oklahoma producers, corn is not as well suited to our climate as other crops, which is why researchers are studying a different approach. Using lignocellulosic biomass, especially from perennial grasses, such as switchgrass.
Lignocellulosic material is grass, wheat straw, trees, and branches. Most of the biomass that you see around is lignocellulosic. The things that we eat are not.
Switchgrass was a major part of the tall grass prairies that covered our state. Even though it's been around for a while, not much is known about growing switchgrass as a crop. OSU researchers are trying to determine basic yields, times to harvest, and fertilizer and water needs, information producers need to know.
This is an interesting plant. You know, this is interesting because it's a native plant. They evolved on this continent, have wide adaptation. That means adaptation to this environment, temperature, water, rainfall, insects, disease, weeds.
Since switchgrass is fairly well adapted to our climate, inputs are lower than many other biofuel crops, which should help increase agricultural sustainability for Oklahoma producers.
Just like wheat, corn, and soybeans that required many years of genetic improvement, so will switchgrass.
Researchers are working to improve productivity, reduce inputs, and enhance disease resistance.
At this point, at least for the last 2-3 years, we did notice that leaf and stem rust is one of the big problems in switchgrass.
Rust is a fungus that attacks switchgrass and reduces yields. Just like not everyone is susceptible to an illness, not every switchgrass plant is susceptible to rust.
So because of the genetic diversity that exists, some switchgrass plants that will be resistant. So that form of resistance is usually can be transferred within switchgrass.
A different solution may be found using a technique called gene silencing. Instead of using switchgrass, researchers are using plants that already have a resistance to rust. By turning off individual genes in these plants, they are hoping to find the one that controls resistance.
So the switchgrass rust cannot infect these plants. So if we can understand the mechanism how these model plants are defending against the rust fungus, then we can engineer switchgrass for resisting this particular fungus.
This research is not only important for rust disease, but can also lead to identifying control mechanisms for other diseases. So, how do you go from this to this?
The focus of the EPSCoR research is how do you transform biomass, and in particular in Oklahoma, what's of interest is switchgrass. How do you transform that into liquid fuels?
A problem with switchgrass is the microbes used in corn ethanol cannot digest the long molecules of lignocellulosic material. Of course, grazing animals have been converting the switchgrass to usable energy for millions of years. A cow is an example of a natural biorefinery. The grass a cow eats is converted into milk with the help of microbes in the cow's stomach.
The cow has a very important organ in its digestive system called the rumen. The rumen has no oxygen, and the bacteria and fungi that are present in the rumen help the cow by breaking down whatever grass, whatever plant material the cow eats.
Researchers are studying whether some of these same microbes could be used to create ethanol and other products. Many other organizations around the country are attempting to directly ferment switchgrass into fuel, but this research has an advantage over those methods.
As of now, many of the plant materials that are used in direct fermentation for ethanol production, they require pretreatment. They require you add enzymes to them, you treat them by alkali or acids to make them more amenable for microorganisms to produce ethanol. And our idea here is, well, if these fungi has been doing it for a long time in nature without pretreatment, it's conceivable that they're better than any other treatment that we use.
Besides converting biomass directly using special microorganisms, OSU and OU are exploring an indirect method. Using a process called gasification, all types of biomass can be converted into a gas. The gas can be further processed into bioenergy or other bioproducts. Gasification is somewhat like combustion, except without the flame.
In combustion, for example, you use you supply all air it needs for complete oxidation, so the biomass combusts and it generates heat. But in gasification, we don't supply all the air. Biomass breaks down into a smaller molecules, which is mostly a gaseous compounds, and we can use that gas directly as a fuel, or it can further be converted into liquid fuels.
The gas, called producer or synth gas, can be indirectly converted into ethanol. The gas is infused into liquid. The microbes in that liquid ferment it to ethanol. Then it's distilled. OSU is also experimenting with materials called catalysts to enhance the quality and quantity of the gas.
Catalysts are solid materials that speed up chemical reactions or cause a desired chemical reaction to take place faster while avoiding undesired chemical reactions.
At the University of Oklahoma, researchers are taking a similar yet different approach. Instead of creating a gas, they are creating a bio-oil using a process called fast pyrolysis.
We heat stuff up to 500 degrees C for a couple seconds and then cool it back down and you have a liquid bio-oil instead of a solid.
In the beginning, the pyrolysis oil, it's a wild mixture of many hundreds of compounds. And so the task is to separate that or to just partially separate it and to catalytically convert it into something that is useful, such as fuels or chemicals.
The ultimate goal is to create a process that can fit into existing oil refineries' production flow.
The main objective of the EPSCoR research team is to provide an economically viable and sustainable production system for switchgrass converted into bioenergy.
I think Oklahoma, because of its heritage in energy and petroleum refining and agriculture, lots of land where you can grow switchgrass, for example, I think that will give us a significant edge in developing these biorefineries early.
This could be more opportunities for economic development, including jobs in rural Oklahoma.
With the help of EPSCoR, researchers are bringing a green future to Oklahoma's energy industry.